Forgive me, Father, for I have sinned.
Good afternoon, everyone. Once again, this is Brother Lloyd, and to those who are keeping the Sabbath, Shabbat Shalom. Now, this time I'm going to talk about the sinner's prayer because this is an extremely popular teaching, but I think people need to understand also that just because we accept and believe, that isn't all we have to do when it comes to our salvation and being saved. We have a work to do for the Father. We have to do what He teaches us in this. Understand that His promises are conditional. We're not going to just receive because we say, I believe. We have a work to do. We have to perform according to what He's teaching us in His Word within showing our faithfulness and being loyal and devoted to Him. The children of Israel had plenty of promises before them. They were promised to be given the land of Canaan, but how many of them didn't make it? Because they didn't fulfill their obligations to go into the promised land. Even Moses didn't go into the promised land because he committed a sin against their father. He took glory upon himself, and the father pulled Moses to the side and told him, "You will not go into the promised land because you did this thing." Now, he's still going to be in heaven if you understand scripture. But the father said, you didn't fulfill your part. So that part of the promise, you're not going to receive. So promises are conditional in the word. People run around every day accepting and believing, and it's just lip service. So we have a work to do to receive promises and all these things that the Father, He says He will give us. So let's get into it for a few minutes. Now, when a person prays to the Father that they understand that they are a sinner and they're in need of a Savior, this only what? It only represents that they know and understand and believe that they're full of sinfulness and they have a need for salvation, as we have all been there. Now, all who proclaim to be believers have done this. Now, those who aren't believers, some of them have done this also, but they're not receiving some of the promises and gifts that some of us believers are receiving because they haven't fulfilled other obligations to accepting that or acknowledging that information. See, part one of the sinner's prayer is understanding that we're all sinners. So we can all easily agree on that point, and it's a vital point. Romans 3:10 proclaims this. It says, "What then? Are we better than they? No, not in the wise. For we have before proved both Jews and Gentiles, both Jews and non-Jews," that's all a Gentile is, simply put, Jews and non-Jews, "that they are all under sin." Verse 10, "As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one." The word is clear. No one's righteous. None of us are righteous. So, go with me to Titus 3, 5 and 7. It reads, it says, "Not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to His mercy, He saved us." According to His mercy, He saved us. "By the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost." See, verse 5 is very important to understand when we're looking at what? Works. Romans 3:20 says this, "Therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in His sight, for by the law is the knowledge of sin." Look, people, without the law, there's no sin. Scripture tells us that. Laws simply acknowledge sin. If there were no laws against killing, then killing would not be a sin. Therefore, the law points it out as sin by giving us this knowledge. Laws are not for everyone. 1 Timothy 1:8 and 9 read like this, "But we know that the law is good if a man use it lawfully." See, you have to use laws lawfully for them to be good. Verse 9, "Knowing this, that the law is not made for a righteous man, but for the lawless and disobedient, for the ungodly and for sinners, for unholy and profane, etc., etc. And then in 2 Timothy 1:9, it reads, it says, who have saved us and called us with an holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Yahshua before the world began. Verse 10, but is now made manifest by the appearing of the Savior Yahshua, who hath abolished death and have brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. So through his word, he has brought this to us. So we have to get into the word and understand the word. He brings these things to us. Now, if we go back to Titus 3, repeating verse 5 first, it says, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit. 6, which he shed on us abundantly through Yahshua our Savior, that being justified by his grace, we should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Okay, listen to verses 8 and 9 carefully. Verse 8, this is a faithful saying, and these things I will that thou affirm constantly, that they which have believed in Yahweh might be careful to maintain good works. These things are good and profitable unto men. Verse 9, but avoid foolish questions and genealogies and contentions and strivings about the law, for they are unprofitable and vain. Now, I'm going to talk about that for a minute. Just pay attention to what I just read. Why should we avoid foolish questions about the law? See, this is a thing where people will question you about, well, why do you believe this or why do you believe that? The word says to avoid foolish questions about the law, the Father's law. One, we are told that they are unprofitable and vain. Two, 1 Timothy 1 and verse 4 tells us, neither give heed to fables and endless genealogies which minister questions rather than godly edifying which is in faith, so do. And 2 Timothy 2:14 continues and says this, of these things put them in remembrance, charging them before the Lord that they strive not about words to no profit, but to subverting of the hearers. Now, listen to this. To subvert means to do what? It means to undermine the power and authority of, in this case, who or what? The Father and his word. See, there is nothing profitable in this for you as a believer. Your faith is being challenged in an attempt to cause you to question what you claim you believe. See, the Father says to believe in faith. Don't fall for the tricks of the enemy or you may end up wavering and doubting. See, this is what happens when we start giving heed to these unprofitable and non-edifying things that individuals may say to us. The Father says to accept what he says in faith. See, with that, we can ignore what people are always trying to trick us with or drag us out of our belief with in some of the questioning. Now, understand this. We all know because of our sin that we deserve what? Eternal punishment. Matthew 25 and 46 reads like this. It says, and these things shall go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into life eternal. Matthew 25, 46 reads like this. And these shall go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into life eternal. Now, John 5:29 tells us that the these are they that have done evil. Those are the ones that will go away into everlasting punishment. Now, the sinner's prayer is what? It's a plea for grace instead of judgment, and it is also a request for mercy instead of wrath. Part two of the sinner's prayer is understanding what the Father has done for us to remedy our lost and sinful condition. The Word took on flesh and became a human being in the person of Yahshua, as we're told in John 1:1. And that reads, it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And then verse 14 reads like this, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory and the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. See, he did this for us, not for himself. Once again, he sacrificed and served for the world's sake. He taught us about the truth of the Father and lived a perfectly righteous, sinless life. He died on the cross in our place, taking the punishment that we so rightly deserve. Romans 5:8 reads like this, "But Yahweh commandeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Yahshua died for us." See, he rose from the dead to prove what? To prove his victory over sin, over death, and eternal damnation, as expressed in what? Colossians 2:15 and 1 Corinthians 15. And because of all this, we can have our sins forgiven and be promised what? An eternal home in heaven. See, we're promised that. Let's pay close attention to Romans 10, 9 and 10. I'm going to read those. See, because many teachings really start to teach that all you have to do is confess on the name of the Savior and believe that he rose from the dead and you will be saved. Now, that's true, you'll be saved, but don't get lost in understanding that you have a work to do once you've become saved. Everything is not just going to happen because you've accepted with your mouth and confessed it with your mouth that it's so. Romans 10 and 9 and 10 read like this. Verse 9 reads, it says, "That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God had raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation." Well, it's scripture. It holds true 100% to the teaching. But understand, like I said, when we fulfill these requirements, that this is only the start of our obligation. We have more of an obligation to just confessing and believing, because we can still be lost if we don't fulfill our duties as believers. Many are lost today because once they confess to the truth, they choose to rebel against the Father and his word and go back to the world. See, we all have that option to confess something and then go against it. Now, the Father is not going to fulfill his promise to us if we don't fulfill our obligations. Understand that the teaching of this has to be complete. You have a work to do. Ephesians 2:8 declares this, "For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is a gift of God." Okay, people, analogy time. Give you something to relate to at our level, as a people level. Say you're at a swimming pool. You confess with your mouth that you acknowledge that this individual over here, the lifeguard, is the saver of anyone who may drown, and you believe that completely in your mind and that he has the ability to do so and will. So now you want to swim, trusting faithfully that he will fulfill his promise. Now comes along Mark 16:16, which reads like this, "He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned." Okay, now pay attention. We know that you are baptized in what? In the word. So what you do is you read all the words that govern your desire to swim and what you must do and obey and follow to remain protected if you do so. If you jump into a pool violating the governing rules set forth for your protection that allows the lifeguard to fulfill his promise, is it his fault if something happens to you? No, it's not. If you jump into the pool in an area where the lifeguard would not be because it's not in his area of serving and you are injured or killed, did he not fulfill his promise? He didn't have a promise to fulfill in the world. His promise was conditional as long as you follow the rules that govern his area of protection. So you have to follow everything within that realm to be protected. You can't go outside of it and expect, oh, well, I believe that this lifeguard will save me, and then go to a neighborhood where it's a bad pool with no water in it, and then jump in it, and then you injure yourself. And then you're wondering, you're saying, the lifeguard didn't fulfill his promise. The Father didn't fulfill his promise. He said he would protect me. He promised me this, but you didn't fulfill your obligations. This is what I'm saying about these types of teachings, people. Understand, we still have a duty to fulfill. John 2:19 reads like this, "Thou believest that there is one God, thou dost well. The devils also believe and tremble." Well, the devils not only believe, the devils know. They know that it takes more than believing. They know that there are things that have to be done that they in no way can do to ever be allowed to get back in heaven. They will never be allowed back in heaven. And this is the same for us. We have obligations to fulfill also to receive the promises. See, saying the sinner's prayer is simply a way of declaring to the Father that we're relying on His Son, Yahshua, as our Savior. It's only faith in Him and His death and resurrection that can save us. See, it's a gift that we have the choice to accept or not. Here we go again with that free will thing. See, still, if we accept it, there's a work for us to do, like I keep saying, not our work, His work. See, we have to do His work, not our work. Faith without works, James 2:20, is what? Is dead. See, did not Abraham show his faithfulness in carrying out the Father's work when he was asked to sacrifice his own son? And was he not willing to do so in faith and obedience? See, he did that in faith and obedience, trusting and believing that the Father will fulfill His promise. It's the same for us. See, if we truly accept and believe these things, we will become a new creature by turning away from the sinful things of the world and follow His word, His teachings, and do what we're supposed to do according to this. And we will do them not of our own power, but through Him in faith and our trust in Him. So with that, remember, the Heavenly Father doesn't call on us to be successful. He calls on us to be faithful. This is Brother Lloyd. I'm out.